Nobody listens to you, Maya. Nobody listens to your warnings. Not a senator, not a congressman, and not a president. What do you say now?
Well, it gets pretty discouraging, and the fiscal irresponsibility and the recklessness just keeps on going. You are absolutely right. I think the problem is that fiscal responsibility versus partisan giveaways doesn't stand a chance. This is a moment where our political process is just so eager to fight it out between the two parties, and the only kind of bipartisanship you ever see is, I'll borrow for my priority and let you borrow for yours. But honestly, not to mince words, I can't remember a time when the fiscal situation was this bad, the economy was strong enough that we could be accommodating sensible policies, and Congress got in line behind a terrible deal to do something as fiscally reckless as it appears they are about to do.
Yeah, I mean, I can remember the strong economy of the late 90s where we actually were generating surpluses and people were talking about the national debt going away. We're going in a very different direction. Give me the numbers right now. I mean, we're looking at the national debt, but the deficit numbers from your perspective right now, and also what it would mean if we actually did see a meaningful increase in interest rates in terms of the budget.
Great. Okay, here's where we are. So the debt relative to the overall economy is the worst it has ever been in this country, other than one time just after World War II. Right after that, the debt came down. We are on track to borrow well over $13 trillion over the next decade. So this debt will continue to march and become in unprecedented levels. Trillion-dollar deficits as far as the eye can see. As you mentioned, when the economy is strong in the past, we've headed towards budget surpluses. But here our borrowing is growing so that interest payments in the budget are the single fastest growing part of the budget. Right now, we are on track. So next year, we'll spend more on interest than we do on children. In 5 years, we'll spend more on interest than we do on defense. And as you said, highly leveraged, highly vulnerable. If interest rates were to go up just one percentage point of GDP, that would increase our interest payments by $190 billion a year. So what does Congress do? It used to be that also when they increased the debt ceiling, the Boehner rule was you increase the debt ceiling for every dollar you increase it, you decrease spending by a dollar. Here we are with a bunch of people about to support a deal that increases the debt ceiling and increases the debt at the very same time, possibly to the tune over our next decade of as much as the tax cuts cost in the trillions of dollars. So we are, you know, it's just as though all constraints have been thrown, cast away, and nobody is focused on the issue of the long-term health of the country anymore.
But can you blame them, Maya? I mean, interest rates have not gone up. They've gone down. And central banks around the world are embarking on a new round of easing. And we're going deeper into negative territory in Europe. And that helps pull down our rates. And we've got a Fed chair that, you know, wants to keep the expansion going for as long as possible. We've still got the reserve currency in the dollar. So everybody's going to want to buy our debt and buy our dollars for a long time. I'm not saying none of this could end or there couldn't be a day of reckoning, but it's hard to see how to get political will and urgency when all of these factors are at play, which can keep the debt going.
Well, let me start by saying absolutely I can blame them for serving as terrible stewards for the country. This is a bipartisan, really, abdication of responsibility. And of course, we should hold our politicians accountable because what they're doing is opting for short-term political gains instead of long-term responsible choices. We all know that you need to have a budget in place. We do not. We all know that you can't borrow recklessly and endlessly. You can't borrow towards prosperity. And yet we're moving forward on that. And the fact that interest rates are so low both means we're in a great situation to get on top of, get control of this. But it also reflects a pessimism about the long-term growth in the country and the actions of central banks that we're not quite sure how to handle going forward. But just because you're a college student with no income and a credit card company offers you a credit card, it doesn't mean you should spend up to the limit all the time. Right now, the U.S. has the luxury of low interest rates. We should take advantage of that to help fix this fiscal situation rather than wait until tomorrow when the cost could show up in so many painful ways. But we really are leaving ourselves immensely vulnerable to a situation that cannot continue.
Maya, always good to hear from you. And
so negative. It's astounding that a time where we should be having decision makers really getting ahead of these problems, they're just so willing to constantly take the kind of cheap, easy way out.
It's not really astounding. That's the thing.